traditional medicine. When I talk about traditional medicine, I'm talking about hospitals, pharmaceutical companies, anybody in medicine, anybody who makes their money in medicine, who gets reimbursed from insurance companies, they don't make money off of two types of people.
Okay.
Healthy people and dead people. They make money off of chronically sick people. It's like a built-in incentive structure, but it would be nice if you had a healthcare system where doctors were incentivized to keep you healthy. They don't have a platform for telling people about all these health hacks that keep people healthy. And I thought it would be fascinating to tell everybody about that and really spotlight the people that are making this happen, staying vital, staying healthy, staying sexy, staying young. Is what living life is all about. And if you have doctors that have proven treatments that keep people young and healthy so they don't get sick, you want people to know about these treatments and that they exist.
This show comes out every Tuesday, always looking for the latest, greatest health hacks. We've already covered an enormous amount of information. This is a really exciting show. And so what we ask you to do, if you're listening to this on just the audio, subscribe to it at iTunes. Just hit that subscribe button. Welcome to Health Hacks with Mark L. White. We got a great show for you. Now, before we get going, I want to remind you to please subscribe on Apple Podcasts or Google Podcasts or Facebook, Twitter, wherever you're seeing us, YouTube. Make sure you subscribe because you don't want to miss any of these shows. They're fascinating, each and every one of them. And Mark L. White, before we get to the doctor here, you had an amazing weekend down in the Bahamas. Quickly, can you tell us what you did?
Well, I wouldn't call it amazing, Rusty. I would call it really thankful. And, you know, like we were able to go to the Bahamas on a humanitarian mission.
Wow.
We were the first ship over. We went on the grand celebration with a bunch of other CEOs and medical people. And we basically spent 2 days helping pass out supplies and helping people evacuate. It's such a terrible situation there. People should be aware that there are people over there right now who have no food, no water, no housing.
Wow.
They're on an island. It's really not easy, and they really just need our support and our prayers.
Quickly, was it worse than you thought it would be from watching TV? Was it better? I mean, what was it like?
Well, we were in Freeport, which wasn't hit as bad as the Abaco Islands, Marsh Harbor. Marsh Harbor was destroyed. At Freeport, they had a 20-foot storm surge. So basically, everything was washed away and all the homes were ruined. And wow. You saw a lot of destruction, but there were still structures standing.
Wow. Well, I commend you for doing that. I know you don't like talking about those kind of things, but you did an amazing thing, and thank you very much for going down there. What's the health hack today? Who's our Dr. Mark, and what are we talking about today?
Well, I'm so excited to have Dr. Saxena on our show. You're in Chicago. You're with Forum Health, correct?
Well, our headquarters are in Chicago. I'm based out of our Tampa office.
Oh, you're right up the street from me. We're in South Florida. That's awesome.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And Dr. Saxena is a functional medicine doctor who has really come a long way to help people stay healthy, help with preventative health care. And I'm just so happy and blessed to have you on our show.
Thank you so much, Mark. It is a pleasure. I'm excited to see what we can do for people today.
So how would you define functional medicine? What does functional medicine mean, and how does that differ from traditional medicine?
So, funny thing, I used to use the word traditional medicine when I first went to a functional medicine conference, and they said, well, you can't really use the word traditional medicine, Shilpa, because it's really more modern medicine. A traditional medicine has been around for thousands of years. So I've now started calling quote unquote traditional medicine conventional medicine or modern medicine. And how functional medicine is defined in relation, kind of an easier way to look at it is that most of modern medicine is centered around diagnosing something. Mm-hmm. And I kind of have this sticky way of remembering it, which is we name it, then we blame it, then we treat it, and then we street it. So we get a name for the diagnosis. So
it sounds like what I do to my computer when it starts whacking out on me. I figure out what's wrong with it. I treat it. I send it away to the store. They fix it.
Yeah. And then you hope that it works. And then if it doesn't, then you name the new problem, blame it for why you have all your misery. And then you look at the guidelines that have nothing to do with your personal situation, but what works for many people in a trial. And then you treat it, and then you treat it again. And so that's why many patients in the conventional system are getting frustrated, because it's more of an effect management system, a disease management system, or a symptom management system. And what functional medicine is all about is identifying the underlying cause of what ails you, not just naming it. The naming of it doesn't really do much for it in functional medicine, because a condition like depression could have 20 unique causes. So naming it depression doesn't tell you what to do with it. But saying, hey, you have a neurotransmitter imbalance because of some sort of issues that happened in your gut microbiome. Well, now we know what the cause may be by listening to a very detailed history and partnering with the patient. Now we address the microbiome. If we address the cause, that's how we reverse or reduce the effect. So we are really like cause doctors versus effect managers.
That's actually super interesting. So you find what the root cause is, and if you treat the root cause, the illness goes away.
It's really logical, and I'm not sure why we haven't been doing it for much longer. Actually, I do know why.
I bet pharmaceutical companies probably have a thing or two to do with that.
Yeah. And you know, modern medicine was born around 200 years ago when people had pretty good lifestyle. You know, we used to eat organic by default. We moved around a lot. We stressed far less than we do now. And we slept kind of normally. And so what we needed doctors for were like magic bullets for, you know, the occasional strep infection, or you needed surgery. So what we've done is use that same like acute care model and now applied it to diseases of lifestyle, and it's just a mismatch.
So like, what if somebody, if somebody's feeling stressed out, depressed, their sex drive's down, what do you do? And why would somebody come and see a functional medicine doctor as opposed to like, I'm going to go to my psychiatrist, or I'm going to go to my traditional doctor?
Yeah. So when you talk about someone having low energy, hormone dysfunction, and mood in the conventional system, you might need to see three different doctors, because those are three different branches of issues in your tree of life. And why you'd want to see a functional medicine doctor is because if you were a gardener looking at your tree of life and you saw three distinct branches were all not faring well, you wouldn't just mend three individual branches. You'd be looking at the trunk, you'd be looking at the roots, you'd be looking at the soil. So when you go see a functional medicine doctor, they would help start figuring out what your unique reasons for having hormone imbalance could be. For some people, it's that their liver is not working. For some people, it's that they're highly stressed and their thyroid and cortisol and adrenal is affecting their hormone system. For some people, it's another medication like a statin that's depleting their testosterone, their testosterone production that is the cause. And so you would address those unique causes. And yeah, you might give them some safer hormone replacement in the interim, but to get ahead of it for the long term and get the sustainable kind of therapy, you'd want to address the testosterone or the statin or the stress or the microbiome or the liver, whatever it was.
At what age should somebody go see a functional medicine doctor?
They should do it before they're born. So okay.
I bet your patients have no say on that.
Well, the mothers do. And as more and more mothers are learning about how just the in utero time period affects how a person's life plays out, these moms are coming in while they're pregnant and making sure they have enough EPA, DHA, that their microbiome is in check, that they're not getting toxins in, and that they try to have a vaginal delivery and all these things that set the child and the adult, the future adult, up for success.
When you say microbiome, if you could just put it in a layman's terms like myself, what is a microbiome and why is it important that we even care?
So your microbiome is the trillions of bacteria that line your gut, and they actually are in the driver's seat of what happens with your body. And these bacteria, it's kind of like real estate. You've got good neighbors in this neighborhood. You've got some, you know, less than optimal neighbors in the neighborhood, but if there's enough good guys, they keep the bad guys in check. And then you've got kind of your neutral neighbors that are just kind of there taking up space. And this little community, which we call the microbiome, determines how your immune system's gauges on the world. So if you've got more good guys than bad guys, then your immune system is what we call tolerant. It's not inflamed. And so when you look out at the world, when your immune system looks out at the world, it's able to stay peaceful. And if it's able to stay peaceful and not inflamed, you can avoid 80% of the diseases that people get. So it's considered to be the driver of disease more and more in research. And it's just simply the bacteria that live along your gut lining that you either feed well and treat well, or you treat like, for lack of a better word, crap.
So let me ask you this then. I would assume diet has a role in the good guys versus the bad guys. What can we do to get rid of or detox all the terrorists and murderers and all the ugly bad guys that are sitting in our biome?
You know, there is this Native American story that my integrative medicine fellowship teacher taught me, and that is, if you want to get rid of the bad guys, make sure you're feeding the good guys, right? Nope. So the people or the bugs that survive are the ones you feed. So you can actively kill the bad guys, but actually by feeding the good guys keep the bad guys in check. So eating foods that feed those bacteria. Some people will take probiotics. Some people have fermented foods. Avoiding the foods that you might have a sensitivity or an allergy to would keep your good guys more powerful. And so long as you have more good neighbors, they keep the bad ones in check.
Is there a blood test people can take to know what foods they should be eating?
What I would tell you is that the gold standard, although everybody just wants kind of a quick and dirty blood test and tell me what I'm supposed to eat, not eat, the gold standard is what's called an elimination diet. So if you even got a lab test and it told you you're sensitive or potentially sensitive or allergic to these five foods, until you eliminate all five of them for around 2 to 4 weeks and then reintroduce them one ingredient at a time, that paper is just a guide as to what could be. The elimination diet and reintroduction is where the money is. And this is actually agreed upon in functional and conventional medicine.
So did you originally get trained as a conventional doctor?
Yes, I am a board certified family physician with a certification in obstetrics, and I'm really big on prevention. But what I realized within 3 years of practice is I was a legalized drug dealer. And I basically said, okay, come back in 3 months and I'll refill these. And if you're worse, I'll add another one in. And I just realized it was just the wrong strategy. So what's interesting is if you let your patients talk and actually listen to what they're doing, they're very smart. And that's how I got introduced to dietary supplements and all these other strategies people are using. And my mindset is you can't tell people no until you understand what it is. So I would say, I don't know what you're talking about. And then that's where I started finding courses about all these evidence-based supplements and therapies and procedures, and realized there's a whole nother field out there that is in line with what I think most doctors thought they were going to be doing, which is healing, not just managing.
Did you have a major influence as you started your journey away from conventional medicine to functional medicine? Was there somebody who kind of blazed that course for you?
I would have to say it was the culture that I grew up in. I was always open as an Indian American. You know, my grandmother used to have these turmeric and ginger cocktails when I was sick. And I used to think it was all like backward sounding, like, come on, I'm going to have this turmeric and it's going to make a difference. And then, of course, as I go further and further into medicine, everything my grandmother has been talking about is proven by science because it's been around for thousands of years, but also the other experience is my own personal experience with infertility at age 28. I went through the conventional system and, like many people, was told, like, there's really nothing that's wrong with you that we can find. So good luck. And it just wasn't good enough for me.
Well, would you say there's a difference in like Eastern medicine versus Western medicine? I see, like, I've heard this story, and I don't know if it's true. It might be anecdotal, where Chinese doctors actually get paid or incentivized to keep you healthy. And when that patient's no longer healthy, that doctor didn't do his or her job.
Well, what I would tell you is that would be, that would definitely be a step in the right direction. The problem is, for us in this country, you can support a patient with everything they need. And sometimes there's factors that relate to the patient's kind of ability to follow through on elimination diet or afford the supplements. You know what I'm saying? Like, so if they can't follow through, but in China, it might be different in a system of healthcare where it's all maybe covered by the government. But your first question, what's the difference between Eastern and Western medicine? Western medicine tends to be organ system based diagnoses. Mm-hmm. So like, oh, you're coughing too much, go to the lung doctor. Oh, your heart hurts, go to the heart doctor. It's very much a divide and conquer kind of strategy. Whereas in Western medicine, or excuse me, whereas in Eastern medicine, they look at the body as a whole tree. They mm-hmm. they won't look at one branch without making sure they look at the rest of the tree to figure out, is this branch off because of the branch, or is it off because there's something going on in other parts of the tree? So they treat the whole system, not just one organ.
It makes sense. It seems like having very siloed approach, having different silos to your organs, it's not, you know, that's why people have to see three or four doctors to figure out what's going wrong. But is there a magic supplement a person could take? Like, if you had to say, what are your top three supplements, what would you mm-hmm. recommend?
I would say that most people in the U.S., even Floridians, are deficient in vitamin D. Mm-hmm. So, of course, to check your vitamin D levels, because it's a fat-soluble vitamin. So you just can't, more is not better with vitamin D. So most of my patients are in at least 5,000 international units mm-hmm. as adults, and they can go up to 10,000 IUs a day. The next kind of supplement that I would recommend would probably be an omega-3 fatty acid. So not a cheap, like, big box store fish oil source, but a real high quality EPA DHA, because it's anti-inflammatory, great for the brain, great for the heart, great for everything. So you've got your hormone and immune signaling power with vitamin D, you've got the anti-inflammatory benefit with your fish oil. And then if I had to choose a third one, gosh, this is hard, Mark. I mean, I might pick a probiotic, because I will make an assumption that most people's guts need some more friendly neighbors.
How does somebody know if they need more friendly neighbors? Is it just gut pain? Is it that you're getting sick all the time? Like, what's the symptoms associated with a out of whack microbiome?
Yeah, it was probably any disease or a symptom that lasts for a long time, meaning months, is what we'd call a chronic disease. And more evidence shows that it's probably starting in your gut. But let me just say this one other thing. You can't go eating fast food, sitting on your bottom all day, stressing and not sleeping, and think that these three supplements are going to undo that. All these supplements do not work effectively if you are not combining it with lifestyle. So in terms of literally any branch of that tree of life could be improved with vitamin D, fish oil, and probiotics, likely, coupled with good lifestyle.
Okay, so let's get into lifestyle. What do you recommend lifestyle choices? I know we're going to talk about sleep and diet, and I guess stress and exercise, but like, when we say sleep, what do people need to sleep? And what happens if people can't sleep?
So can I share a little sticky phrase that I use to have people think about lifestyle?
Stick away.
Okay. So I call it the goodness way of living. Okay. So goodness, the word good is to remind you that you've got to be actually good with yourself. What does that mean? To be good with yourself, you have to have your mess in order, your mental, emotional, social, and spiritual health. If you don't have your mess in order, it's very difficult to be good with yourself. This is like where you're whole, complete, like satisfied, full of purpose. Now that's really important to get your mess in order, mental, emotional, social, spiritual. And if you have your mess in order, it's much easier to get the second part of lifestyle, the goodness. The NESS is nutrition, exercise, sleep, and stress management. So what most people do is go to the nests and they're like, I don't know why I can't stick to this diet, or I don't know why I can't exercise. Clue, your mess is not in order.
So that's mental, emotional, social,
and spiritual. Yes.
Okay. So spiritual, that you can open up a whole, you know, you can go a million directions there. Is it meditation we're talking about? Is it finding religion? Like, how does somebody find peace or harmony?
Yeah. You know, what it is figuring out what gives you purpose and connects you to something greater than yourself. So for some people, it's about like connecting with nature. You can absolutely have spiritual health and be an atheist. You could be very connected to the purpose of helping people who are affected by hurricanes like you did. I mean, that is a purpose. That is a spiritual gift, and that was spiritual health you got in the process of service. Now, some people will pray, some people will do rosary, some people will chant, some people meditate, but it's whatever brings you closer to peace and purpose. And there's not one right way. So some people run and they get into this like meditative state. Some people sing. It's just something that kind of releases this deep relaxation or sense of purpose in you that gives you the clue that this must be it.
So I was watching a speaker, and he was saying that if you can write your own your obituary, if you could talk about what you want to be remembered by, and focus on making that your lifestyle, having some sort of goal bigger and beyond. Okay, next week we got to hit our numbers, or you know, tomorrow I got to do this goal, but have a goal for your life. Like, how do you want to be remembered? How do you, you know, so for me, it's family. For me, it's about making a difference and giving back.
But it's beyond family for you. It seems like your purpose is greater than your family. Otherwise you wouldn't have boarded that cruise ship to go help thousands of people in Bahamas. I would argue that you're vested in something even bigger than your family. And yet, it also serves your family that you got spiritual health in this process of helping others.
Well, you want to make an example for your children. It goes beyond that, but I agree. I think giving back to those in need are very important. What do you think about journaling or gratitude?
Mark, that is an amazing mechanism, because you know what it does actually physiologically when you're grateful, or when you're journaling, what you're grateful about. Generally, you can absolutely journal your feelings, but I would take it a step further and journal what you're grateful for. And what that does is it improves what's called your vagal tone. You have this involuntary nervous system in your body, and what it's in charge of is trying to decide if you're in survival mode or in healing mode. And when you do things like meditation and journaling and feeling grateful and serving others, your healing mode turns on. We call that the parasympathetic nervous system. So anything that gets you to relax, and not just relax, like be distracted, like watching TV shows and binge watching TV, that's not relaxation, that's distraction. Mm-hmm. We're talking a deep sense of relaxation and like where things just come together. That's what's great for you. And the higher your vagal tone, the longer you're going to live. In fact, Mark, there is this great book called The Blue Zones mm-hmm. by Dan Butner. This was a National Geographic journalist who traveled the world to find the healthiest 100-year-olds, like mm-hmm. pockets and communities. And there's, I want to say, 9 similarities, and 5 of them have to do with community purpose, mm-hmm. belonging, social health. There's a couple on nutrition. There's one on exercise, but over the top, it's about things that have you feel connected and purposeful.
Yeah, I think Costa Rica, Okinawa, and they talked about how people are not alone. It's all about serving your community and giving back. And I think there's been studies that show people that are lonely as they age, they don't live long.
Exactly. So I think there's this beautiful quote, and it's, and of course, I'm not going to say it exactly the way it is, but somebody, if you ask someone, you know, if somebody asked me, how long do you want to live? Or do you want to live long? How do you live long? I would probably say that the way to know is just have a purpose that's going to last you your whole life and as long as you want to live. If you have a purpose that'll last you 100 years, you'll live 100 years, because we live for purpose. And when, you know, seniors or people, it doesn't even have to be seniors, when they start to become marginalized, that's when disease sets in much quicker.
Now, that's great advice. Let's talk about like your top health hack. Like if people are going to hack their health or come up with a shortcut, what would you recommend?
My goodness, I have so many. Do you want to give me a prompt on any one that's of interest to you?
Well, how about rest, or, you know, giving your organs a rest, or giving...
Yes. You know, there is one that I believe would be an easy, no cost hack, and that is a digestive fast. So I always talk about how your digestive system, remember we talked about our microbiome is our mm-hmm. digestive system, and you've got all these bacteria. Well, think about these healthy bacteria that they're your employees. So you've got 1 trillion employees, and just like in the real world, like you work your employees around 8 hours a day, and then you got to give them some time off, because if you don't, they don't come back to work as tolerant and rested and ready to take on whatever you're going to throw its way.
They quit.
Yeah, they quit. And then they start getting irritated with the thing that you have them do. So your digestive system, if you can work towards it, would love to just work 8 hours a day. So what people can do is like maybe eat from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. or 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. I surely wouldn't recommend that you eat from 4 p.m. to midnight, because no employee loves to do that shift over and over. So if you can, and many ancient systems of medicine recommend doing this kind of fasting, if you will, mm-hmm. where you only work your digestive system for 8 hours every day.
I think intermittent fasting is big, and you actually see that with a lot of religions, the fasts during Ramadan and you know, during Jewish holidays. So, you know, I think our forefathers were onto something.
Absolutely. There's so much data on caloric restriction and anti-cancer benefits. And then when you couple caloric restriction and exercising, that's amazing for your brain health, heart health. Yeah. So it's just treat your digestive system and treat your body like an employee. Like, don't work it all day and work it hard, because it's not going to be with you long term. It'll quit.
That's something I've got to learn for myself. Dr. Saxena, so nice to have you on the show. If somebody's listening to this and they want to get in touch with you, what's the best way for them to get in touch with you?
So they can always also look up my name, because it's pretty darn unique, and they'll find multiple routes. They can also follow me on social media, whether it's on our Form Health Instagram and Facebook, or on my own, which is Saxena MD.
And that's SaxenaMD.
Correct.
It was such a pleasure having you on the show. I'm going to go give my microbiome a rest right now. but thank you so much. It was really great having you.
Thank you so much, Mark. And thanks for doing what you do. This is another service and spiritual health thing that you do, sharing wisdom with everybody else.
We just got to get the stories out there. Thank you. And if anybody's listening to this and they want to help with the Bahamas hurricane relief, there's an organization called missionresolve.org. They're looking for all kinds of all kinds of donations. It's going to take months to rebuild those islands, but you can go to missionresolve.org. 100% of the proceeds go to the people directly in the Bahamas.
Awesome. Well, if you are looking to find out more information about Mark L. White, go to marklwhite.com. Also, if you would please subscribe to this podcast, whether it's on YouTube, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and make sure you let everybody know about Health Hacks with Mark L. White.